In this set of slides, I would like to go through the steps to test a hypothesis. So in the previous slides, we discussed looking for context clues that would allow us to identify an alternative hypothesis. In this set of slides, we will examine, okay, well, we've identified the alternative hypothesis, we wrote down the null hypothesis, and now we would like to actually use the data that we've obtained to test the hypothesis. And so we're going to examine a step called constructing a test statistic. To go back to the slides from just the last lecture, the test statistic explicitly compares the sample to a claimed parameter. So what the test statistic does is it describes the location of our data relative to the null hypothesis. And the thought process is that if our data are relatively far away from the null, the most reasonable thing to conclude is that there's support for the alternative. We should stay away from concluding that we just obtained an unlikely sample. Okay, what do we need to test a hypothesis? Well, first and foremost, we need a hypothesis. That was what the previous lecture was about. So let's pretend that we have one. Now what? We need data. You need a random sample of data from the population of interest. So I should have some process to collect the data where I don't influence the outcomes of the responses. So ideally, you know, if I'm doing a survey or something like that, I do it in a way where responses wouldn't change based on how I delivered the survey. So I have a sample from the population that's representative, and I give the survey in a way that doesn't bias toward any particular response. Once you collect the data, you need a measure of the middle, because we're hypothesizing about the middle. We're hypothesizing about the value of the population mean. So I need to construct a measure of the middle from my sample. That's a sample average, sample mean, X bar. I also need a measure of dispersion. So people's responses will differ. If people's responses differ wildly, the null is more likely to be reasonable, because the null is more likely to fall into a non-trivial set of those responses. I measure that with the standard deviation. How far are my data from the mean? The sample size, N, is also important. So I change how I draw my conclusions based on how much data I have. This is the information that I can collect from any quantitative sample. I can always count the number of data points. I can always take the average of those data points, and I can always find the standard deviation of those data points, and that is all I need to test a hypothesis. Now, you do want to be mindful about how confident you want to be in placing the data into either the null or the alternative. So data are going to differ in how far away from the null they are. The further away they are, the less confident I am that the null is reasonable. So as the data move further and further away, I may reject at a 90% confidence, or a 95% confidence, or a 99% confidence. Okay, so what determines how far is too far? Comparing the test statistic to a critical value. Critical values we described as being cutoffs of plausibility, where once our test statistic is further away than these critical values, it becomes implausible to think that the null adequately captures the value of the population mean. So this isn't to say that it can't be the population mean. What we're saying in these circumstances is, based on the information you receive from your sampling process, you cannot reasonably justify claiming that that's the population mean. So in the numerator, we physically compare the sample mean to mu, which is from our null hypothesis. That's the claim about the population mean. The denominator, we have the standard deviation divided by the square root of the sample size. So as we have larger and larger samples, the test statistic inflates because the square root of n gets bigger and bigger as n gets large. So the larger the sample, the bigger the test statistic if everything else is the same. Okay, so let's go back to the oil change example that we had in these previous slides, where a chain of oil change places recommends oil changes every 4,000 miles. And they want to see whether or not customer behavior is significantly different from their recommendation. So I look at significantly different, I think, okay, that's a not equal sign in my alternative. And because I used a two-sided test, there's just an equal sign in the null. Now I get a sample. I sample 55 customers, and the average number of miles is 4,323. So that is not the same as 4,000. The standard deviation is 535.85, so a fair number of customers are below 4,000, but a number of customers are in the 5,000 range. The claim in the null was that the mean is equal to 4,000. So our test statistic, I plug 4,000 in for mu, I plug 4,323 in for x bar, I plug 535.85 in for the standard deviation, and I plug 55 in for the sample size. I get what's a test statistic of 4.47. What does that mean? Here is our sample, 4,323. 4.47, what it does is it shows us where on this top graph our sample is located within the context of using the test statistic to rescale the location. So our test statistic is, a good way to think about it is it's 4.47 standard deviations of this particular sampling distribution away from zero. So if the true mean is 4,000 and I sample 55 customers, based on the standard deviation in the sample of responses for individual customers, it's incredibly unlikely to see a sample mean of 4,323. So it's still technically possible that 4,000 is the population mean, but if you look at the location of our sample, it is very, very far away from 4,000, and in fact it exceeds 1.65, 1.96, and 2.58, all of the critical values. So we have strong evidence to suggest that the alternative is more plausible, and I frame it as I reject the null at the 99% confidence level. Okay, so this slide is super important. How do we make the comparison between the test statistic and the critical value? When the test statistic is positive, as in our case, we compare to the positive critical value. So for two-sided, we compare to 1.65, 1.96, 2.58. And for one-sided, we compare to 1.28, 1.65, and 2.33. We reject if the test statistic is larger. That means our sample is hanging out here. We don't reject if it's smaller. If the test statistic is negative, we compare to negative critical values. How do I get negative critical values? Put a minus one in front. We reject if the test statistic is smaller. That means further away from zero than the critical value, and we don't reject if it's larger. This is the criteria for determining how far is far. We use one-sided values for one-sided alternatives, two-sided for two-sided. Okay, so here, we got a test statistic of 4.47. It's larger than all the critical values, so we reject the null. Practically speaking, it's statistically larger than 4,000. It is statistically significant. This is a statistically significant difference from 4,000. There's a low probability of seeing our sample if the true mean is 4,000. I can describe the results in two ways. I say I reject the null at the 90, 95, and 99% levels. I could also say that the results indicate a statistically significant difference at 0.01, 0.05, or 0.1. Either way is fine. You have to describe your conclusion with one of these two ways. Okay, so let's look at another example associated with TV commercials. Let's suppose you schedule programming for a TV station and you believe that the average number of seconds for a TV commercial is less than 30 seconds. You sample 26 commercials with average times of 28.4 seconds and a standard deviation of 4.9 seconds. So the sample mean is 28.4, the standard deviation is 4.9. Let's take a quick backtrack. What is the alternative hypothesis here? What number is associated with that? And then based on what you think the alternative hypothesis is, what is the null? We have to look for a context clue for the alternative first. Then we write it down. We use what we wrote for the alternative to write down the null. This is going to determine our critical value, so it's important. So take a quick look. I'll give everyone a couple seconds here. Did you find an alternative hypothesis? What we should have found is that the mean is less than 30. Look at the context clue, less than. Look at belief, indicates hypothesis. 30 is their claim for the population mean. You can frame the null in one of two ways. You could look at it as equal 30, but I prefer to look at it as greater than or equal to 30. So if it's not less than 30, it's greater than or equal. What's the sample size? 26. What's the sample average? 28.4. What's the sample standard deviation? 4.9. I construct a test statistic and I get a minus 1.67. Sample mean goes on the left, that's X bar. 28.4, claim mean is 30, standard deviation 4.9, sample size 26. Okay, so our test statistic is minus 1.67. Is it a one-sided or two-sided test? It's one-sided, less than. What are the critical values for a one-sided hypothesis? We start by using these, one-sided left, minus 1.28, minus 1.65, minus 2.33. We use those critical values. So let's just take a look at this on the graph, and we can see visually kind of our conclusion here, but here's 28.4, and we mapped it to minus 1.67, and you can see the little tick mark if we zoom in here as much as we can. See this little tick mark? It is just in the blue. Just in the blue, so I reject at the 95% because minus 1.67 is a little bit further away from zero than minus 1.65. So I can conclude that I reject the null at the 90 and 95% levels. What is the null? That the mean is greater than or equal to 30. So based on my sample, I have some suggestive evidence to support an alternative of mu less than 30. I can also say the results are statistically significant at 0.10 and 0.05. So there's a statistically significant difference of my sample from 30 at these levels. So we are just in the blue here. Data cannot, now with a one-sided left, this is really important. If I had a sample of 38, which is way out here, I'm in the yellow. I can't support the alternative. So the critical values are different for a one-sided hypothesis because we're only looking at half of the bell curve. Everything to the right is thrown out. And it makes sense. So I can't possibly support less than if I have a sample that's greater than. No matter how far away from the center it is, it ain't less than. And that's the sort of key insight that I want us to take away here.